Hi guys, I'm Qi from Carnegie Mellon University. Today I'm going to present our paper about a new attack vector in vertical federated learning system. So firstly, let's introduce some background. To protect users' privacy, most of the regions in the world have published privacy regulations. So under these regulations, companies are not allowed to share their users' data with other companies for commercial use directly, which causes a dilemma of isolated data. So let's say we have a fintech and a bank with a common set of users. However, they hold different features of these users. That is, the data is vertically partitioned. For example, the fintech has a user's deposit and the shopping times, while the bank has a user's age and income. They want to train a model on the aggregated feature space to predict the user's credit. So in a traditional centralized setting, the parties will share their database with each other, and they can train a model on the aggregated data on the aggregated database. And let's say the model is trained by the fintech, and during the inference phase, the bank's private data will be sent to the fintech in clear, and the fintech will aggregate the data together, and will feed the aggregated data to the model to get the inference result. However, due to the privacy regulations, sharing data during training and the inference phase is prohibited. Therefore, the models can only train their local models using their local features, which will result in a significant downgrade in the model's performance. Vertical federated learning proposes a possible solution for such a dilemma. And here we present the paradigm of a popular VFR protocol, which is a split neural network. In split neural network, instead of sharing their raw data, the parties will instead share the local model's outputs. And after the training phase, the fintech and the bank will have their own local models. And the coordinator will have a top model which processes the local model's outputs and returns the VFR final results. And during the inference phase, the private inputs from each party will be fed into their local models, and the coordinator will collect the local model's outputs, and then the final inference results will return to the fintech and the bank. So VFR is becoming a principled and popular approach to coordinate privacy-preserving inference among multiple clients. And the companies holding data from different feature spaces can now perform the inference without sharing their raw data. However, in this work, we show that the VFR inference phase is vulnerable to a new attack, and which we call adversarial dominating inputs. In this work, we prove the existence of ADS in VFR, and we propose gradient-based methods and the gray box fast testing to synthesize ADS. In this talk, I will focus on the gradient-based method, and you can find more details of the fuzzing and more interesting evaluations in our paper. So first, I will start by telling you what an ADS looks like via a concrete example. There are two parties, the fintech and the bank, contribute vertically partitioned data to the inference of the VFR. So the data provided by the fintech is the deposit and the shopping time, and the data provided by the bank contains the user's age and the income. Once the normal data is provided, the VFR can give the correct result of the user's credit. For example, for the user 3, whose deposit from the fintech and the income from the bank are pretty low, and the inference result indicates that this user has low credit. However, let's say the fintech is malicious and wants to dominate the joint inference of the VFR inference. And here we introduce our threat model first. So the attacker wants to dominate the joint inference using adversarial dominating inputs and diminish the contributions of other benign parties. In this way, the adversary can control the results towards their target and hug the rewards during the VFR inference. We assume that the attacker can perturb their inputs to synthesize the ADIs, and during the inference phase, the attacker will provide a tiny collection of data samples to the benign parties, which is used as the benign parties' inference data. And The attacker can also access to their local model and can observe the inference results of the VFR system. We further assume that during the inference phase, the benign parties' inputs will follow their training data distribution. That is, we do not consider the concept of drifting during inference phase. Now let's introduce the adversarial dominating inputs, which is marked in red in this table. The ADS from the malicious fintech can now dominate the joint inference towards their target and force the bank's data to make negligible contributions during the inference. For example, for the user 4, by modifying the user 3's shopping data, they can generate an ADI. Even though the user's deposits and income are pretty low, the inference results still indicate that this user has high credit. So for a majority of the bank's data, when the fintech inputs ADIs, the inference result of the VFR will be dominated by this UDI, by this ADI, and the results will always be high credit. So now the malicious users can cooperate with the malicious fintech, and they can fool the bank together. When the fintech provides the ADIs during the inference phase, even though the malicious users may have very bad records on the bank side, the bank will treat these users as high credit users. So now we formally define the adversarial dominating inputs in vertical federated learning, given a VFR system F with M parties. The attacker is denoted as A, and the benign parties are denoted as B. An input X star is treated as an ADI when the output of the VFR system is not influenced by changing the inputs from the benign parties. That is, the variance of the output with VFR output with respect to the data distribution for the benign parties is bounded by a small epsilon. And we prove that for commonly used VFR systems and any epsilon greater than zero, we can always find such an X star that satisfies this constraint. That is, ADIs commonly exist in typical VFR systems. So now with the definitions, with the definition of ADIs, we can design a gradient-based method to synthesize ADIs. Specifically, we minimize the contributions of the benign parties by reducing the silence score of the benign parties. The silence score reflects the changing of the model's output with respect to the changing of the benign parties' input. So a lower silence score indicates less contributions from the benign parties. We also minimize the loss towards the attacker's target, and we set constraint on the norm of the mutation vectors, so that we can guarantee that the synthesized ADIs are close to the normal data distribution. So to solve this optimization problem, we utilize the gradient descent, and we iterate over the 10 samples S provided by the attacker and use the as benign parties input during the inference phase. We also utilize the projected gradient descent to bound the mutation vector. Now let's present a schematic view to help better understand our algorithm. Let's see the X star is the input from the attacker A that is being perturbed into ADIs, and the XBs are the data from the benign parties that is used as the inference data. So originally, the aggregated data XC star and XB1 will be inside the decision region of label L1. And the attacker aims to mutate the aggregated data to the target region. So by running our algorithm, we can generate a mutation vector V1, which will shift the aggregated data to the target region. However, when the benign parties changes their data, let's say it changes to another one, XB2, the new aggregated data is likely to be inside another classification region, L2, instead of the target region. So again, on top of XC star plus V1, we run our algorithm again, and we generate another mutation vector V2. And the mutation vector V2 will shift the new aggregated data to the target region. So we iterate over the 10 sample S, and we can arrive at a mutation vector V. And for a majority of the data samples from the benign party, the aggregated data will be shifted to the target region. We utilize the momentum in our algorithm to speed up the convergence. So now we have the white box algorithm, and we can extend it to black box using finite difference method. We also propose gray box fast testing to enable in-house quality assurance and vulnerability assessment for normal users and developers. Please find more details in our paper. Now let's evaluate our algorithms. Our evaluation focuses on 6 data sets and 3 learning protocols. And the models are well trained because the models achieve high accuracy on the test data set. So to decide whether an input is an ADI, we check whether the input can dominate 99% of the benign practice data. And in the evaluation, we focus on the success rate, which is the ratio of the samples from the attacker's test data set that can be perturbed into ADIs. So our results show that our gradient-based method can achieve high attack success rate for various data sets. On the standard data sets, the attack success rates are pretty low, which are marked in blue in this figure. And our results are marked in orange in this figure. For example, for the CEPHA-10 data set, we can achieve like 43.8% attack success rate, while the while the standard data set can only achieve like 0.46% of the dominating rate. And also, we explore the possible mitigations. As expected, the traditional adversarial training can be hardly utilized to mitigate ADIs. Even though the model is becoming more robust, we can still achieve very high attack success rate when generating ADIs. We also propose a cluster-based detector to distinguish between the normal inputs and the ADIs, and we can see that we can achieve reasonably high accuracy. For example, for the CEPHA-10 dataset, we can achieve like 67% of accuracy in distinguishing the normal inputs and the ADIs. So to conclude, we prove the existence of ADIs in typical VFR systems, and we propose black box gradient-based method and the gray box fast testing to synthesize ADIs. Our evaluation shows that we can generate stealthy ADIs with high attack success rates, and we also explore the possibility of mitigating ADIs. So thank you all. This is my talk, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Hi, thanks for your talk. I had a question about the existence of ADIs.
Okay.
Is that conditional? Is that like saying there's one ADI for any model unbounded, or is there a bound on that?
Because the proof is mainly for unbounded.
Okay.
So we also prove the bounded mutations, but you need some additional constraints or assumptions.
Okay, because yeah. I was thinking, for instance, in the image case, your pixel values are going to be bounded, and so in that case, you might not be able to always find an example, right?
Yeah, that's true.
Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. You can find more details in our paper. We have some proofs there. Yeah.
I had a question. So yeah. How is this ADIs conceptually different from, let's say, targeted backdoor attacks? Like, if I had like a backdoor attack for like a low income thing, I have a trigger and I can always misclassify it.
Okay. So you mean that this the difference between the ADIs and the normal adversarial examples. So there are a lot of differences. Firstly, the adversarial examples are not particularly designed for the distributed manner. So here, using ADIs, we are minimizing the contributions of the benign parties. And also, adversarial examples are mutating the whole feature space, while ADIs only mutate the feature space of the attackers. So these are two differences. And we also evaluate the traditional adversarial examples in our paper, and you can see that they don't have this dominating manner. Yeah.
Let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.